Good morning, all. Welcome to Bethel Baptist Church. It's good to see you all today. We'll start by singing Shout with Delight. Shout with Delight. Let's stand together as we raise our voices to the Lord.
Shout with delight to the Lord, all you people. Worship the Lord with full gladness of heart. Come bow before Him with songs full of praises, joyful with all of your heart. Know that the Lord, He is God. Know that the Lord, He is God. For He made us, we are His flock, the sheep of His pasture, and He is our rock. Know that the Lord, He is God. Enter His gates with a song of thanksgiving. Enter His courts with your tongue tuned to praise. Our God is good and His love lasts forever. Faithfulness marks all His ways. Know that the Lord, He is God. Know that the Lord, He is God. For He made us, we are His flock, the sheep of His pasture, and He is our rock.
Remain standing for opening prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, You are indeed our God, and we thank You for that. And Lord, we thank You for just all the blessings and the grace that You show us during this time of year, Lord, when we think and are thankful. Lord, we are thankful for all that You have done. Lord, we are thankful for this great country that You've given us, Lord, and we're thankful for our families and friends, Lord, that we can spend time with them, Lord. And we think of those who are still out and just pray for traveling mercies for them as they return and be with them, Lord. We pray for those who are sick and those who couldn't be out, Lord, for that reason and other reasons that are acceptable to You, Lord. And we just trust that You will heal them. And Lord, we just are so thankful for the Word of God. And we're so thankful, Lord, that You saw fit to reveal Yourself to us and that You came to this earth, Lord, and that You lived a perfect life, Lord, and that we can look to You for our salvation. We can look to You for all our needs. And so, Lord, we just would ask Your blessing on this service, that it would be pleasing to You, Lord, that it would bring glory to You, and that we could leave out of here, Lord, with our hearts filled with joy and thanksgiving for all that You do for us each and every day. And we just thank You in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. You may be seated. And if you like, you can turn to John chapter 3. We'll be reading verses 1 through 15. John 3, 1 through 15. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto Him, Rabbi, we know that Thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that Thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto Him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter in the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh, and whither it goeth. So is every one that is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered and said unto Him, How can these things be? Jesus answered and said unto him, Art thou a master of Israel, and knowest not these things? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know, and testify that what we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things, and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you of heavenly things? And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Having a life that is marked by gratitude, well, that will produce contentment. But a life that is filled with gratitude towards God for what he has done for us, understanding what he has done for us that we couldn't have done for ourselves, well, that produces a heart of service and commitment to one's own master. The last verse of our Song of the Month says this: "My heart is filled with thankfulness to him who reigns above, whose wisdom is my perfect peace, whose every thought is love. For every day I have on earth is given by the King. So I will give my life, my all, to love and follow him." Let's stand together as we sing, "My heart is filled with thankfulness."
My heart is filled with thankfulness to him who bore my pain, who plumbed the depths of my disgrace and gave me life again, who crushed my curse of sinfulness and clothed me with his light and wrote his law.
Continue worshiping now with number 316, 316, My Jesus Fair.
To his cross as grace prevailed. God pin my wretched sin. O love divine, O matchless grace, that God should die for men. With joyful grief I lift my praise, abhorring all my sin, adoring only Him. My Jesus pure was crushed by God, by God in judgment just. The Father grieved, yet turned His rod on Christ, made sin for us. Love divine, O matchless grace, that God should die for men. With joyful grief I lift my praise, abhorring all my sin, adoring only Him. My Jesus strong shall come to reign, to reign in majesty. The Lamb arose and death is slain. Lord, come in victory. O love divine, O matchless grace, that God should die for men. With joyful grief I lift my praise, abhorring all my sin, adoring only Him.
We want to welcome everyone today. Be in prayer for those who are traveling and who are ill. Be in prayer for my family that the ones that are ill would keep it to themselves. And the rest of us would be able to take care of them without getting ill. But I think they're doing better today. Do have a potluck right after the morning service. All are invited to that. And right after that, what we'll do is we're going to stay back there and just take some prayer requests. Particularly, I want to focus on those family members that we might be seeing during the holidays. And I'd just like to make a list of family members that we can be praying for, and we'll pray for them. That will just be right after the potluck, right back there, and then we'll all be able to go home for the evening, except for those of us who have a deacon's meeting, which is also happening. That's a budget deacon's meeting right after that. Dine without the wine is not correct as far as the time in the bulletin. That's no fault of Nancy's. It's not correct in the calendar either. So anyway, whenever it is, come. The next time... let's see, what else? I think that's all the announcements that I have. Gentlemen, if you come forward for the offering. I think it's on Saturday at 4, if I remember right. Okay. Yeah. I just wanted to say that to be funny. Anyway. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, just for the privilege of being here today, and thank you for your word. We thank you that Christ is the incarnate word of God. We thank you, Lord, that he declared with great clarity and certainty what was necessary for entrance into his kingdom. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to understand in a greater way today the need not just for reformation but for transformation and a new birth. I pray, Lord, that not only would we be able to understand in a more clear, definable way how that works for someone who comes to know you, but that would become a reality in our lives as we live out the gospel. And Lord, we come to you today and we thank you just for the ability to worship you. We pray for those who are traveling and ill and not with us today. We pray that you would just protect and heal in those cases. Lord, we do pray that you would be worshiped today, and we ask, Lord, that you would help us to worship you in a way that honors you, that is befitting of your character. We cannot do that apart from your grace. It is only because of the grace that is offered to us and applied to us through Christ that we can even worship you in any way that would be befitting of you. And so we exalt Christ today. We are thankful for Christ and his person and his work. And we thank you, Lord, for those things. And I pray that today would be a day where we would be again reminded and refreshed of the truth, the significance of the truth that Christ came to die to pay the punishment for our sin. that we genuinely and truly would be grateful for that sacrifice that Christ made in converting us and making us right and declaring us righteous. And we pray, Lord, that we would just have an appreciation for that today. Lord, we pray that you would use the offering that is taken up today for your honor and your glory, for the furtherance of the gospel and your kingdom in our community and around the world. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest.
for our final song before the message. We'll sing number 75. Number 75, sing Praise to God. Let's stand together as we sing, and children can be dismissed at this time for junior church. Praise to God who reigns above, the God of all creation, the God of power, the God of love, the God of our salvation. With healing balm my soul he fills, and all his faithful's murmur stills. To God all praise.
Bibles and turn to John chapter 3 this morning. John chapter 3. I think you guys have already compensated for this. My voice is not as strong as it usually is, so I appreciate you getting the mic up to where it needs to be. John chapter 3. And let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you, Lord, just for the privilege of being here, and we are about to enter into a discussion on a passage that is quite familiar to us, but one that it's really doubtful that we have all fleshed out in the way that perhaps we will this morning. And it's also doubtful that we are as consistent as we ought to be in applying the gospel in this way in our lives personally. And I pray, Lord, today as we go into your word, that you would help us to understand it, that you would help us understand the nature of what you have for us here, what your requirements are for kingdom citizenship, what it requires to see the kingdom. And then, Lord, may we apply this to our lives, our Christian lives, in a way that will really not just be reformational, but transformational. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Let me begin by asking you a question this morning. Does the Christian experience the following difficulties? Discouragement, defeat, confusion, rejection, hurt, and sin. Of course, every single one of us that know the Lord would say, yes, we experience all of these from time to time in our lives. Well, I have a second question for you that I want you to think about, and we're going to flesh this out in the message this morning as we come into what is a very familiar passage of Scripture in John chapter 3. And the question is this: is it possible that the Christian makes these matters worse by forgetting the fundamentals of the faith? If you think of that list and you think of despair and discouragement and hurt and sin, is it possible that we make matters worse because we are forgetting the fundamentals of the faith? We're forgetting the salvation, the great salvation with which Christ bought us and changed us. And I'm going to argue that we do that, that is the case. Now, I want to ask, and it's not up on the PowerPoint, but I want to ask one final question about this, and I want to really think about this. I'm going to argue here, folks, that if we will apply the gospel as Christians in the way that He wants us to, that we will be able to resolve the difficulties in our lives. Not that we won't have them, we certainly will, but we'll resolve them in a manner that is much more befitting of a Christian. But the question then becomes, how do you know if the gospel is still having an effect on your life as a Christian? Now, of course, we're not talking here about being redeemed from the penalty of our sin. If you know Christ as your Savior, if you genuinely do, if you have experienced the rebirth, then you are guaranteed eternal life. You are guaranteed everlasting life, a life in heaven with God, where you are now already free from the penalty of your sin. But when it comes to being freed from the power of your sin, and when it comes to experiencing and living out the gospel, the question I would just have for you as we go into this text is, how do you know whether or not you are living out the gospel? We have talked about it a lot in our lives, in our church, in our ministry. I try to emphasize it in our ministry, but it is helpful for us to be able to know whether or not this is happening in our lives. And when we're and really the issue is, are we experiencing the new birth? Not do we have it? Although that ought to be a legitimate question in our minds as we go into this. Do we genuinely have the new birth? But also, are we living by it? Are we experiencing it in our lives? Now, with that in mind, we're going to go into this passage, and I want to mention this as well. This passage where Nicodemus comes to Christ, it is a very familiar passage. It is one that we have read many, many times before. The most common verse in the Bible is in verse 16 of this chapter. And it is one where if we're not careful, we could check out. And I would really encourage you not to do that. In fact, what I really encourage you to do in this passage, as we read it and we study it this morning, I would encourage you to look at it from a first-time mentality, as though you have never read this passage before. And what you're going to find as you read it and we go through it is it may look very different to you than if you have just assumed that you know what it's talking about. With that in mind, let's look at verses 1 and 2, or actually 1 through 3 of this passage. It says this: "There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And the same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus, who is a Pharisee, it says that in this passage, and a ruler of the Jews, has been seeing the miracles, those things that John calls signs. He's seen these that Jesus has done. He has heard of the signs and miracles that Christ has done. And he makes the assumption that this man must have come from God. And so he comes to God with a question. And we're going to see what comes to Christ with a question. We're going to see what that question is. But notice, first of all, that the time that he comes by night. So he is coming to Christ to ask a question, perhaps that he thought in his mind he should have already known. We know that Christ feels as though he should have known this, because later on in the passage, he is going to say, "Are you not a teacher of the Old Testament, yet you don't know these things?" But Nicodemus comes by night and he wants to ask Jesus a very important question. And that question is going to help us understand the significance of this text, except that when you read it, you don't find it. Did you notice that? If you read the text, we note, verse 2, that he comes to Jesus and he says, "You are a rabbi." And he emphasizes, a rabbi, by the way, is like a master teacher. And he emphasizes, again, this word teacher. So he's emphasizing the fact that Christ knows the law and has great ability to expound on the law. And of course, that's true. And that the source in which his power comes is from God. And he identifies the fact that nobody can do these kinds of miracles that you have done unless you come from God. So he says, "You've come from God." But then you see in verse 3 that Christ picks up and says this, "Verily I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now, let me ask you this question. What we have got to do is we've got to infer from this text the question that Nicodemus is asking without knowing what it is. But this is not too hard to do. Have you ever been listening to somebody that's having a conversation on the phone? And you know by their statement what question is asked. Have you ever thought about that before? You've listened to somebody on the phone, they've said a statement, and you know that a particular question is asked. You can determine the question by the statement. And that is essentially what you have in this passage. Christ, by his statement, you can infer the question. He says here in verse 3, "Except a man be born again," what's the next phrase there? "He cannot," what? "See the kingdom of God." And so from that statement, we would then infer that either Nicodemus did ask of this and it's not recorded in the text, or he had it in his mind. But either case, the question in Nicodemus' mind is this: how can I see the kingdom? That's the question. It's inferred there, right? Or it's implied there. We infer it. How does one see the kingdom of God? That's his question. And folks, that is an important question to ask. It is a question that would have been on the minds of the nation of Israel. They were expecting a Messiah. They were expecting someone to come. And it is one that another of the Gospels deals with at length. You see it all over the place where it says, where Christ is saying, he's talking about entrance into the kingdom. In the book of John, you see this only mentioned once, this phrase, entering into the kingdom. But in the book of Matthew, for example, and Luke and Mark, you see it multiple times, but particularly in the book of Matthew. And for us to understand the significance of being born again, we must first understand the significance of this seeing the kingdom. And by the way, what Christ says here in seeing the kingdom is he is going to point to the entrance to the kingdom. He says, if you're not born again, you cannot see the kingdom. But in seeing the kingdom, you must first enter the kingdom. And entrance into the kingdom is only by being born again. But what is the significance of this idea of entering into the kingdom? In the book of Matthew, Matthew deals with this issue of entrance into the kingdom several times throughout the book. And what I want to do is just mention, just by way of, we're not going to delve deep into this, but I want to mention four important facts about what Matthew talks about when he talks about entering the kingdom. First of all, entrance to the kingdom requires internal righteousness instead of external righteousness, external conformity. And you find that in Matthew chapter 5, verse 20, where it says, "For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven." In that Sermon on the Mount, the great sermon that Christ gave to his disciples and others around, he says that in order to enter my kingdom, you must not only have external conformity, you've got to have internal righteousness, which is going to require an internal change. Secondly, in Matthew, we find that entrance into the kingdom requires the ability to do the Father's will. At the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Christ, if you'll recall, talks about two roads, two gates and two roads and two destinations. And he says that one is broad and everybody goes into that road, and there's a narrow way and only few find it. And he says, you know the difference between someone who's found the narrow way and someone who's found the broad road. By the narrow way is the person who is able to do the will of God. It presupposes then that the person who is able to do the will of God wants to do the will of God. And that occurs by the person who is conditioned to be able to enter into the kingdom. Thirdly, entrance into the kingdom requires conversion through humility. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 says, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as a little child, children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Then finally, Matthew chapter 19, the very next chapter, you're going to find a narrative where a rich man comes to Christ and asks how he can enter into the kingdom. And Christ explains that he can do so if he will keep the law, including love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, soul, and mind, and love thy strength, and love thy neighbor as thyself. And he says, you've got to give up everything you've got in order for you to follow me. And he says there then that he couldn't do it. The rich man couldn't do it. He turns away and he says, if you are going to enter into the eye, it's harder for a rich man to enter into the eye of a needle than to enter in God's kingdom. And by the way, that eye of a needle is a sewing needle. They didn't have the other kinds of needles that have been suggested, by the way. Some people suggest that the eye of a needle was talking about is actually a gate that's lower and you can't get through as easily. That didn't happen until the Middle Ages. And so that's not what it's talking about there. He's simply saying that for someone to enter into the kingdom who doesn't know his need, it's not possible, or it's very difficult. So my point in going over this is to understand that this entrance into the kingdom is something that is on the minds of the Jewish readers. And it's something that is like the prime question for the nation of Israel. And folks, very frankly, it ought to be the prime question for all of us. Do we have what is necessary for entrance into God's kingdom? And what we find is that Christ wants to be very clear about this. And in John chapter 3, the emphasis is not so much on what it will take as far as our effort or what it will look like. The emphasis is on the change of the person. And you'll notice here in the text it says, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now, folks, we know that phrase, don't we? Every one of us has heard many times, hundreds of times, maybe thousands of times, this phrase, born again. But when Christ is saying this, what is he saying? What is he trying to get across? Well, look at verse 4. What we're going to see in verse 4 is we're going to see Christ's explanation that is introduced by another question of Nicodemus. Verse 4 says, Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can a man enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? From Nicodemus's question, we then know that Christ has presented to him a very foreign idea. Nicodemus has no idea of what Christ is talking about. He is not aware of it. He has not thought of it in these kinds of terms. And he says, can you go back into your mother's womb and be reborn? But essentially, Christ is saying that is what it would take. It would require that because those who are born into sin, and they are utterly insufficient to be able to enter into the kingdom of God. But in saying this, he is emphasizing something that is very important for us to understand. He is emphasizing that there needs to be not just reformation, there must be transformation. Throughout history, there have been all kinds of ways and all kinds of methods that have been suggested from various religions on how you can reform your behavior. on how you can reform your thinking and reform your lifestyle and how that is what is necessary in order to become into right alignment with God. But Christ says reformation will not work. What must be is transformation. And that is why Scripture is going to later on elaborate on this concept in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 through 18, where it says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation." How are we reconciled to God? It requires a new birth. And of course, we are all familiar with this, and if we're not careful, we can lose the significance of it. Reforming is not enough. And one of the illustrations in Matthew, as you saw in verse 19, or chapter 19, or as we referred to in chapter 19, of the rich young ruler, he was really essentially asking, what can I do? How can I reform? What is it going to take for me to be able to enter into the kingdom? And Christ says, you can't. You've got to change. It requires transformation. The Apostle Paul, in describing what must happen and what did happen for someone who is born again, says this: "Even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened or made us alive together with Christ," Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5, "by grace ye are saved." In that passage, he points out that someone, because of sin, is spiritually, entirely spiritually dead. He has no life. And what Christ must do is revive him, must make him alive. And when he does this, it says in verse 6 of that chapter, Ephesians 2, "and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is a gift of God." Now, let me just ask you a question. And I'm doing it to make, I think, a point that we've got to just keep in mind. If someone were to come to you and say to you, "How might I enter into the kingdom?" Would we offer to them reformation, or would we require of them transformation? In other words, sometimes it's like, well, if you will pray a prayer and you'll clean up your ways, then Christ will accept you. If you will do this certain thing, then Christ will accept you. But that is not at all what the requirements are. The requirements are transformation. And so what we have in Scripture is you've got to, it's a new birth. This, of course, back in John chapter 3. And by the way, let me just use another term that will help us with this. It is another word that will be helpful as you read various commentaries and just works on the subject. The word is regeneration. So what God does in making us alive again is regenerating us. Verse 4, Nicodemus asked that question, how can somebody go into a mother's womb and be born? And verse 5 says this: Jesus answered, "Verily, verily." He says, "truly," or "certainly." There, in other words, Jesus comes back and says, "Look, this, I am going to be as dogmatic as I can on this point. You're not wiggling out of this. Verily, verily," he says, "I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Now, what Jesus does there is he says, you've got to be born of water, you've got to be born again, and then he defines, or he really describes the process of what that is. You've got to be born of water, and you've got to be born of the Spirit. And let me just say to you that there is a lot of debate on what the water is in this passage. very few people have disagreement among what the Spirit is. Most would agree that this is the Holy Spirit of God in this passage, that you've got to be born of the Holy Spirit of God. But when it comes to the water, there is much disagreement. And I'm going to take an extended amount of time to deal with this, because it will, number one, it will help us to understand the nature of the new birth, but it will also help us as we rub shoulders with those who might use this passage to as a basis for what we would call baptismal regeneration. And there are many groups out there, many religions out there. The most prominent in our minds would be Catholicism, but certainly the Church of Christ, I believe also Seventh-day Adventists, and many other groups, folks, Presbyterians of certain kinds, not all. They believe in what is called baptismal regeneration, that you, in order to really be born or born again in the way Christ describes, you must be baptized. And usually they believe in infant baptism in order as a mode of doing this. In fact, the leading scholar of the book of John prior to his death in 1995, he was actually a professor at Johns Hopkins, a real professor of religion in Johns Hopkins. His entire library on the book of John is in a Catholic library that I like to go to up in northern Baltimore. And they have a lot of books, not just Catholic ones, but I'll just mention that. Raymond Brown is the guy's name, and he really put forth this idea. Of course, he has a Catholic influence, but he put forth the idea that what the water is in this passage is baptism. And before you immediately say, well, that's just ridiculous, the last time the term water has been used, other than turning water into wine, but prior to that, in John, had to do with baptism, John's baptism, John the Baptist. So that is, among Christendom, among broader Christianity, that is the most popular, the most common view on this passage is baptism. Well, there's a couple of problems with that. But I'm going to get to the problems in just a few moments. I want to mention a couple of other, what would be viable views, but I think perhaps would not be right views. John's baptism is another view that is not talking about baptism that we have to undergo, but in this context, he's talking about John's baptism and that Nicodemus needed to participate in John's baptism in order to be able to have, to be born again, and that is a possibility, though I don't think is probable. Physical birth is another one that comes up, and in the context, that would be kind of our immediate choice. He says you have to be born physically and spiritually, and so some people take that water as the amniotic fluid, and so it's talking about physical birth. The problem, folks, with that idea is that water is never mentioned in Scripture, in the New Testament, or historically in the first century as being a euphemism for a physical birth. So it seems unlikely that Christ would use that as an example, although in the context there's no problem with that. I mean, the context would bear that as a view out. I don't think that's the best view either. And others would suggest that what he's talking about there is ritual washings. And I think that would be actually opposed to Christ's theology, which was internal righteousness must be required, not external righteousness. So with all of that in mind, what is the right view on this? What is the right interpretation of this water? And because Christ is saying that it is necessary that you are born of water and of the Spirit. Well, there's a couple of things that we've got to understand in the very beginning of this if we're going to understand this. First of all, do you notice what it says here in the passage, this word of? Verse 5 says, Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born." Do you see the word water, word of there? Of water and do you see that your King James Version has inserted the second of? You see that? It's in italics. I mean, there's no problem doing that. They tell you what they're doing. But there is no second of in the Greek. In other words, you've got a preposition and you've got an entire prepositional phrase after it. It indicates that there is a unity between these two concepts of water and spirit. In other words, what we're talking here is about one transaction, one happening. Not that you are baptized physically, that you are spiritually born. No, and not that you are physically born and then spiritually born. There is really, the way this is structured, the most natural way to take this is it's one thing that's happening, one event that's happening with two components. And so that would knock out the idea of baptism. It would also knock out the idea of birth, of physical birth, water meaning physical birth. And so I would suggest to you that the grammar does not bear that out. And so that's important for us to understand. So what is he talking about? The second thing that we need to realize about this passage that will be helpful for us in understanding what this water is in the passage is to understand that this really the context is in view of explaining the law. Or, let me put it this way, explaining the Old Testament. The reason I say that is that Nicodemus, in his initial stages of coming to Christ, he says to him, Rabbi, you are a teacher. And then later on, Christ is going to say to Nicodemus, don't you know you are a teacher of the Jews? Don't you know that, why don't you know what I've already been teaching you? So, folks, what it indicates is that whatever Christ is talking about, there is at least some treatment of this in the Old Testament. And what I'm going to suggest to you is we're going to find that in Ezekiel chapter 36. So what I'd like you to do is take your Bibles and turn there to Ezekiel chapter 36. And you're already saying, Ezekiel, I thought we were studying John 3. I thought this was going to be a simple message. I mean, what in the world? Well, John 3 might have a little more to it than you might realize at first glance. Ezekiel chapter 36, we're going to pick up here in verse 25. Now just keep in mind this. Ezekiel is written during the Babylonian captivity. Ezekiel is written during a time where the nation of Israel they've been disbanded essentially. They're not acting or executing as a nation. The nation of Israel is very concerned about this. And of course, this is as a chastisement for their failure to in our idolatry and their unrepentant spirit of after many, 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 many times of God giving them opportunities to repent, and they don't. And so he turns them over to be chastened by the Assyrians and Babylon. And so now they are in Babylonian exile, and they're sort of wondering, what is going to happen here? Are we done? What is God going to do? He has promised to fulfill the Abrahamic covenant to us in some way. How is this going to work now? And we find in Ezekiel chapter 36 some of the answer to what Christ is going to do and he's going to fulfill in John and in the New Testament. Ezekiel 36 verse 25. Then I will sprinkle clean. Now notice this, folks. I will sprinkle clean what? Oh, we've got water there, don't we? I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean. Now let me just pause and ask you, what is the use of water in this context? It is for cleansing. Well, what kind of cleansing? Are we talking here, folks? Are we talking about taking a bath? Or a shower? Is that what we're talking about here? Are we talking about physical cleansing? Well, continue. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. We're talking, folks, here about spiritual cleansing, aren't we? Verse 36, a new heart. Oh, that sounds familiar, doesn't it? A new heart also will I give you. And a new, what's that word? A new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh. And I will give you an heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And ye shall keep my judgments and do them. Folks, what do you suppose he's describing in verses 26 and 27? The new birth. So what he's describing, we find an illustration of this in chapter 37. He's going to talk about, you remember the illustration of the dry bones which God awakens, and we're going to look at more of that next week in part two of this same passage. We'll look at that later. But folks, do you realize here what we're talking about is a prophecy of the new birth? And what was necessary in the beginning of this? There was by water a kind of what? Of cleansing. All right, now with that in mind, take your Bibles and turn back to John chapter 3. And in John chapter 3, what you're going to find in this passage is that he is then going to say this in verse 6. And we're going to come back to this idea because we're not done with the word water. But I want to get to verse 6 just to show you the connection here. Verse 6 says, that which is born of the flesh is what? Is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit, capital S, and they got it right there, is lowercase s what? Spirit. He's saying this, that when the Spirit of God does its work in the life of a person, he puts into them a new spirit. That's exactly what it said over in Ezekiel, doesn't it? I mean, it's exactly what it says. I'll give you a new spirit and a new heart. I'm going to give you the ability with which you're going to be able to be born again. And in order that's necessary, you're going to have to be cleansed with water. You see then, folks, that what the water is talking about is a cleansing of our hearts, a cleansing of us. There's a cleansing that has to go on. Now, let's just verify this by John's own usage of the word water. How does John use this? Would you notice in John chapter 4, the next time that this word water is used, you don't even have to turn there, you'll know the story about the woman coming to the well. Remember, Christ is meeting the woman at the well and he says, I'm going to be able to give you what? Water that will spring up into everlasting life. Well, so water produces everlasting life. But also, we have another association that's going to help us in John chapter 7. Would you notice it says, go ahead and turn there, John chapter 7. We're going to see another use of water. Verse 38, and who believes in me, as the Spirit has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of what? Of living water. But this he spoke concerning what? The Spirit of God. How, folks, is John using this term water? Well, he's using it to demonstrate that what happens from it is a new birth, or is everlasting life. And he demonstrates that what happens from it is the Holy Spirit. He's referring to it in reference to the Holy Spirit. Well, let's move on and look at another place in John again. John chapter 13, okay, and you'll know this story too. Christ comes to Peter and wants to wash his feet. And he's going to use what? He's going to use water. And Christ said, and Peter says, don't wash my feet. And Christ says, I've got to wash your feet. You're not clean. Of course, he's not saying that you're not clean physically. There is a figurative sense in the term he's using. And so we see water used again, both as a physical illustration for spiritual cleansing. So it is entirely keeping with the way John uses this word. And the way the Old Testament uses this word to really solidify in our minds that the word water here has to do with our cleansing. But how is it that we become cleansed? And if you take this term clean or cleansing and you run that through John, you're going to find the answer to that question. So would you're in John 13, flip over a couple of chapters to John 15. John chapter 15, this is a very well-known chapter about abiding in Christ, as Christ is the vine and we are the branches. And in John chapter 15, you are going to find, now, verse 3, now ye are what? You are clean through the word. Titus 3:5 says this, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. How is it that we are clean? We are clean, it says, by the word in that passage. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, we find, or verse 26 says that the husband can sanctify his wife and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word. We see in that passage that the word does the cleansing. And 1 Peter, in fact, go ahead and take your Bibles and turn there to 1 Peter chapter 1. You're going to see this. It's going to clinch it for us, I think. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. He says this. Since you have, what's the word there? Purified. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Why can you do this? Having been what? And he uses the term. What's the term, folks? Born again. Not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all glory of men is the flower of the grass. The grass withers, the flower that falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached unto you. All right, so let's go back to John chapter 3 now, and we're going to see what he is saying here. Let's just pick up here and just ask the question. Christ is talking. Nicodemus has said, how can you be born again? And they're like physically born again. Christ says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye a man be born of water and of the what? Folks, what do we know about the Spirit of God in conjunction with the Word of God? Is the effects of the Word of God enough apart from the Spirit of God to bring someone to salvation? And we should say no. Nicodemus had the Old Testament. He had the Word of God. He had enough information there in order to be able to understand what is necessary for entrance into the kingdom, but the Spirit of God was necessary in order to show him the significance of the truth that he was reading. And so Christ says, you've got to be cleansed by the Word of God, and this happens by the Spirit of God. You need the Word of God being used by the Spirit of God in order for you to be regenerated. It's got to be both. It can't be one or the other. And so we see here in this passage that both are necessary, the Word of God and the Spirit of God, to bring regeneration. To bring, let's use another word, transformation. And he's going to begin to explain this further. He says in verse 7, do not be surprised. Don't be surprised by this. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. Don't be surprised by this. I mean, folks, let's just think about this. The kingdom of God is a perfect kingdom. The kingdom of God has no flaws. Why on earth would we ever think that we are going to be sufficient? It is, don't be surprised that you've got to be remade completely from the inside out. And he tells Nicodemus this. Verse 8, he explains the working of the Spirit of God. He says, the wind bloweth where it listeth. Now, this is very interesting. He uses the word wind. The word wind in the Greek is the exact same word as the word spirit. It actually could be translated, the spirit blows where it listeth. In fact, some translations actually do that, some of the older translations. I think wind is accurate here because I think he is using the wind as a divine illustration of how the Spirit works. But what do you know about the wind? Can you see the wind? You can't see the wind. How do you know that the wind is there? You know the wind is there by its effects. A couple of weeks ago, we had leaves on the trees, and I was watching the leaves come to the ground, and I was saying these leaves need to be get cleaned up. They're everywhere. They're getting into the building. They're getting everywhere, and I thought to myself, we don't want to clean them up yet because we're just going to have more, until finally we got a good wind. And the wind, literally one day, I'm seeing leaves in the trees. I come in the next day, and there's no leaves. And I emailed Caleb, and I said, come clean them up. We're ready now. Why? Because the wind blew them all down. We see the effects of the wind, though we don't see the wind. And folks, you can't see the Spirit, but when someone is truly transformed by the Spirit, when there is that transaction, you know the effects. You know the Spirit of God has worked because of its effect in the person's life. But he's saying something else here as well. Do you notice what it says here? He says, the wind bloweth where it what? And that's just an old-fashioned term for where it wants to go. The wind goes where it wants. It goes where it wills. And thou hearest the sound thereof, and canst not tell whence it cometh, whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit of God. Folks, it essentially is saying here, whether we like it or not, that there is a divine will. And that the Spirit of God will convict. He will do His work in illumination. He will do all of these kinds of works in the life of the person as He chooses, and you'll know the effects of it. So when someone says, I want to reform, when someone says, I want to do better, when someone says, I need to turn over a new leaf, that's not what Christ is talking about. He is talking about transformation. He's talking about a new birth. Now, I want to ask, just by way of application, this. The reality is, what God wants for us is He wants for us to experience the new birth. Christ is not speaking here about intellectual assent, but the work of the Spirit of God. And He is not speaking here of turning over a new leaf. He's talking about recreation. He's talking about not reformation, but transformation. And what He wants us to do is He wants us to ask the question, are you living out the gospel? Let me ask you this question. We started off with this. How do you know? How do I know when we are genuinely living out the gospel in our lives? Well, let's ask this question. When do we stop living out the gospel in our lives? Well, somebody gets saved. They genuinely have a conversion experience. You definitely see that they want to do what's right. There's a change in their life. But of course, you know that over time, sin hits or discouragement hits or something hits. And it is as though they're not living out the gospel anymore. Sometimes it's quickly. Sometimes it's long, many years. But folks, all of us struggle with this. Everybody here, many of us have been known the Lord for many years. How do we know whether or not we're living out the gospel? Well, you say, well, how do you know when you stop? Well, you say it's when you sin. And certainly that's the case. When we sin, we're no longer living out the gospel. But what causes this to happen in our lives? What causes this to, I mean, if we're really new creatures in Christ, what would cause sin to be allowed in our lives? Folks, I think the best way to answer this is what would cause someone to not get saved in the first place. And it is, folks, it is unbelief. What causes sin to occur in the life of a Christian who has genuinely been born again? It is some form of unbelief. And it may look like this. We forget who we are. Or we forget the significance of Christ's forgiveness. Sometimes we do what we do. We fall into sin because we forget who we are. That we are a child of the King. That we have been born again. We've been bought with a price. We just forget who we are. Or sometimes we forget the significance of Christ's forgiveness. We're not grateful for it anymore. We take it for granted. We don't appreciate it in the way that God intends for us to appreciate it. And it becomes something that is normal in our lives, where we just accept it for what it is, but we don't really appreciate it. We lose our gratefulness for the gospel. We're not living in light of it. We're not thinking about it. We forget the greatness of the forgiveness in our lives. No wonder God allows sin. I mean, think about it. If you have forgotten or aren't grateful for the forgiveness of your life, what will bring you back to reality about the gratefulness of forgiveness in your life? If you sin, and then you experience God's forgiveness, then suddenly you will be grateful again. Thirdly, we forget that God's plan for us is far better than our plan for us. Sometimes we want to force what we want, to do what we want, and we are not believing that God's plan for what He wants is better than our plan. Folks, when we do that, we're not living out the gospel. We're living in unbelief. We are living in a place where we are not living out the gospel anymore. The truth of the matter is, all of these passages that may very well have clear, direct application for an unbeliever so that they understand how to enter into the kingdom, there is an application for us as Christians. We must continually be transformed. And that's why Paul says in Romans chapter 12, be not conformed to the world, but be transformed, he's saying this to Christians, by the renewing of your mind. How do you know whether you're living out the gospel? Well, if sin is in your life and you're trying to reform it, it won't work. But if you have found yourself in sin and you experience God's transformation, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That is, you change your mind. That is when you know you are living by the gospel. And I would just ask you this question. It's the same question. It's the same emphasis that Christ is emphasizing in Nicodemus. Are we focused on reformation or are we focused on transformation? And whether you know Christ or not, if you don't know Christ, or maybe you think you know Christ, but there never was a transformation in your life. Or maybe you know Christ, but you're not living out the gospel because you're trying to reform rather than transform. Folks, how do you transform if you know Christ? The same way God transformed you when you came to Christ. It is by the Word of God and the Spirit of God. And do you know, I mentioned to you in the very beginning of our message in Matthew, how he treated the whole concept of entrance into the kingdom. And I think we really have a clue here about how to live the gospel. It requires humility. Christ said in Matthew 18 that if you're going to have entrance into the kingdom, you're going to have to come as a little child. You're going to have to be converted and come as a little child. He's saying that you've got to have all humility in this. You can't do it on your own. You can't think you're ever going to do it on your own. We've got to have a humility that allows us to see the Word of God and the Spirit of God do transformative work in our lives. That is how we know we are living by the gospel. Like every head bowed and every eye closed for just a few moments. I just want to give you time. I just will tell you that being reminded in my own heart of these truths have been so helpful, so important. It is amazing to me how much one can know and yet forget. Maybe in your own life, you're thinking of something that you need to reform. You're thinking of something that you need to fix. But what God wants to do in your life is a transformation from the inside out. And I would encourage you this way, and I will just tell you by my own, I've applied this to my own heart before I ever preached it. I don't know why we get so into this mode of reformation rather than transformation, except we have our own flesh to deal with and our heart is deceitful. But if there is an area in your life or in my life where we are trying to apply reformation rather than transformation, I just encourage you to talk with the Lord about that in the quietness of this moment and say, Lord, would you transform me rather than reforming me? Would you transform me rather than I trying to do the work of reformation in my own strength? I just want to give you a couple of minutes and then we'll pray together. Father, we thank you that by no self-effort on our own, we have been, those of us who have entirely accepted you by faith alone, have experienced the work of the gospel in our lives. But we admit before you that we are so inclined toward reformation rather than transformation. Our hearts are deceitful. Our flesh is strong. I pray, Lord, that in our dealings with our own heart, our dealings with our own behavior, that you would help us to have a humble spirit so that we can experience transformation, that we can continually be transformed by the renewing of our minds. It is by your word and your spirit that we are saved, and it is by your word and your spirit that we live out the gospel. I just ask, Lord, that you would help us to remember these truths. I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.